This episode of Film Riot is brought to you by FreshBooks. Day fresh to death. Welcome to Film Riot Mondays. I'm going to change my shirt. First question, what would be the best way to pull off a larger action scene that has multiple fights going on at once? I think a lot of that really rests on style and what you want your audience to feel. For me, if there's cross-cutting happening between two moments, I'm not going to look at those two different fight scenes as their own entities and then try to cut them together later. I think that's a mistake, at least for me. I would write it that way, knowing where this fight would pause for a moment so we could pick up on the other fight and then vice versa. For instance, maybe there's two fights happening, right? And we're in this fight and at some point the bad guy throws a good guy through the window who he lands in a totally different room now, rolls and has a moment to breathe in camera. And that gives us a chance to jump to the other fight to pick up where they are. And then we get sort of a pause moment on that fight as well. Maybe it's a moment where this person's being, you know, drugged to something very, very dangerous. And we could cut there now because we're leaving that sort of cliffhanger for that fight, and we come back to find this guy crawling away. He's all cut up from the windows, while the bad guy's walking in behind him to pick him up and pick that fight up where we left off. But we still have the cliffhanger of that other fight, knowing that that guy was dragging our other hero towards some kind of saw that's in motion or something, which lets us bring it back to that. So thinking in those terms of constantly leaving your audience on little cliffhangers that they want to get back to that fight, but they're really excited about this fight too, and jumping between it in that way, I think it's how I would handle it to give the best experience possible for my audience. I asked this question last week, but I will ask again, how would you prepare for a documentary? I have not done a lot of documentaries. I did these like mini docs for Alienware when I worked there. And there was one where we did about Katrina victims. So that was a pretty serious subject. But other than that, I haven't really gone into that sort of thing. So I don't have a lot of advice to give you there, but what I would do is know everything imaginable, everything that I could possibly get my hands on, I would know about the subject before I went into it, so I would be informed in how I wanted to tell the story. And then it would be a matter of trying ahead of time to find what the heart and soul of that story is, but my instinct tells me you wouldn't really fully find that until you were in the midst of it. You're shooting this thing, you're coming acquainted with this world, with this person, whatever it is, and you discover it while filming. Oh, that's what it is. That's the heart of the story. And then once I found that, I would let that dictate everything I did around that. I don't know if it's helpful, but that's how I feel like I would approach it. Again, I haven't done a full documentary. I've only done these mini docs, but that's how I approach those. And I think that's how I would approach any full length. A film is never finished, just released. If this is true, then when do you know when it's time to let the Deer Project go and release it? I think it's true and it isn't. I mean, that's really talking about in the studio system when you have a release date, the studio's dictating when you have to stop now. This is how much time you have and then you're done with the film and you have a very finite period of time because it's all dictated by budget. You have this much money for post-production, so you have to get the film done by that much time. And I think those people would always love a little bit more time, but they run out of that and they have to release it. They don't have a choice. For people more like us, when we're making our own thing and putting it out, there really isn't a set release date on you. I mean, we have forced release dates a lot of times, like with UFO, yeah, we announced when it was going out, so we had to put it out. Portal was the same thing. There was a specific time that it had to be out because we were in partnership with somebody else. So there are times like that where we do have forced dates, but it isn't always that way. And for us, it's less of a films are never finished, they're just released, and it's more of a you need to learn when it's time to stop, when it's time to call it done, walk away, and just put it out there. Because at some point, I think you start doing harm to it. You're not helping it anymore. You're actually going backwards. You hit a point and then start regressing, not progressing with that project. I think it's the same thing with scripts. At some point, you need to stop putting your hands on it because maybe some things get old that were great, but now they're kind of feeling old to you. So you're overthinking things, and things that were really good, you're doing damage to because you're thinking about it too much. And I think getting people that you can trust to show it to and get notes will really help you with that. But I think it's something that you just need to kind of get experience in and knowing when something is, you know, as good as it's gonna get, and to walk away and move on to the next project. What are your thoughts on DIY stabilization? I am just getting into cinematography and really want more stable shots, but I am on a very tight budget, as in like no dough, LOL. The cheapest form of stabilization is a tripod. Just putting your camera on a tripod and then there you go. I mean, if you can do some kind of DIY stabilization trick, then absolutely, whatever works. We've shown some on our show as well. I don't think you need $1 billion gear to pull off what it is you're trying to pull off. I mean, even if you can get it close enough, warp stabilizer and post is gonna get you the rest of the way, as long as you're smart about how you're shooting it. And again, don't worry too much about gear or specifically doing it this one exact way. Worry about what the story it is you're telling. What you have to tell that story can dictate how you do it, but worry about the story that you're telling and the experience that you're giving your audience, and everything else will fall into place. So whether you're working with a $10,000 piece of gear or a $5 piece of gear, it does not matter. Whoever's watching the production is gonna have no idea what it looked like behind the camera. Just worry about what it is that story is that you're telling that person. Last question, screenwriting. How do you get your audience to care about your characters? This is definitely something that I'm still working on, still trying to figure out fully, constantly working towards, because it's so important just as much as the story. Story and character go hand in hand. And if your audience isn't on board with your character, they're probably not gonna be on board with your story a lot of the time. So it is extremely important. And for me, it's just about finding a way to get my audience to relate to and empathize with that character. There's a ton of different ways to do that, but doing something that endears them to that character or just gets them to understand that character's side of things. Just like in real life, if you want, you know, someone to care about someone else, they have to be able to empathize about that with that person, you know, empathize with whatever their situation is. If you have somebody who's hard on their luck and you want to get people to help them, if you really dive into what their story is, who they are, you know, how they fight for things, they're fighting for their family, blah, 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 but they keep falling on their face time after time, you're going to pull on people's heartstrings and, you know, that's going to work. And it's kind of the same thing within a script, is not necessarily giving a sob story or anything like that, but finding a way to put your audience in your character's shoes to where they understand and relate with them, and that'll make them want to take the journey with them, want them to succeed, and so on. At least that's how I see it. Spring is almost here, and if you're someone who struggles with tax stuff, listen up. Our friends at FreshBooks have created ridiculously simple cloud accounting software that helps service-based small business owners get a handle on their paperwork. FreshBooks keeps all your cash flow details in one place so you know exactly what invoices you sent, who has paid you what, and what your income is. Their mobile app lets you take pictures of receipts and organize them for later, which makes claiming expenses at tax time a breeze. You'll be much more prepared and way less stressed. And right now, FreshBooks is offering a 30-day trial to our viewers. Just go to freshbooks.com/filmriot and enter filmriot in the how did you hear about us section.
Logo.
So that's it for today, which means it's time for my suggestion of the week. This one is a behind the scenes look at Bear McCreadie doing the score for 10 Cloverfield Lane. It's a really short video, but it gives kind of a look into the things that they did to make the score, which I thought was really interesting because they used some unique instruments, which I love seeing the behind the scenes of any sort of score in action. I really love that stuff. And this is one of my favorite scores in quite some time. That throwback sort of modern mix vibe that's going on with it, I'm really in love with, which you can find the soundtrack, of course, on iTunes or Spotify as well. So check those out. And until next time, don't forget to write, shoot, edit, repeat.